So in this particular case, this is a new thing we're doing. We are going to create a new report. So we have the data management we're doing in Polygon. At the top here, we have a menu bar, and depending on the menu that you have selected, you can see that the tools available in the rhythm change. So it's a bit like Microsoft Office, where you've got different tools in rhythm depending on which feature you're looking at. And then within the report, when you have different kind of panes, depending on which pane you're working in, the ribbon will also automatically change to give you all of the tools which are available in that ribbon. It's kind of like, you know, Excel. When you first open Excel, the tools that they give you are to essentially input data and adjust your columns. And if you want to create a line, a graph, you go to insert, choose your graph, and then once you've inserted the graph, when you select the graph, the ribbon automatically changes to give you all the options that you can use when editing your graph in Excel. At the bottom, you have your time bar. That will become active once you load a trial. On the left here, we have the data bar. So you can see it's in like an auto-hide state at the moment. If you want to, you can pin that down so it stays permanently on the left side. And likewise, we have the same for our attributes. Okay, so the data bar will list all of the trials that you have imported into your report. And over on the right side, all the attributes are things that you can edit, so things like colors, and the display layout of the objects or things that you have currently selected. And finally, in the middle here, this is the middle section here is your report. Okay, so it starts off essentially as a text pane. So within your text pane, you can see we've got functions like you have in Word, where you can just go and write in a header for your report. Okay, and then you've got all the functions like you do normally have, where you can change your font and your size, you can make it bold, change the color. In your report, you might want to put some information such as the name of your subject, or if you're working in a clinical sense, you might want to put your subject ID, and then you can put other things if you want to, like say age. So I'm going to come in and go back to my data manager. And I'm going to import the trials that I want to work with. So I've top one dimensional here, so it's an input that I just double click. And you see it's populated the trial in the data bar, and underneath that I've got things such as my events, and under my subject name I've got more information such as my kinematic and kinetic data. Alright, so what can we display and see in Polygon? The one thing I forgot to mention at the start about Polygon is that you need a license, obviously, to create the report. But once you've created the report, you can export it as an executable. And brings out a package. And as long as all of those files remain in the same folder and in the same structure, you can then give that, that folder to somebody else to view the report without them needing to have a license or install in the software, because it just runs as an executable. So whether you want to give this to, you know, the athlete that came in, or if you're working with a sports surgeon or doctor, then you can always create a report for them, export it as an interactive report, and they'll be able to navigate through the report as you create it. Or alternatively, you can also export it out to a PDF file as well. I'm just going to import the Martha file. And so one of the displays that you have is called Bones, and this creates a 3D workspace or a workspace view. And for some reason we don't have that yet. Okay, so we've got a workspace view here. And you see, instead of getting those sticks like you have in Nexus, when we do the modeling process and we get the single bones, we can then apply a mesh to our subject. And you can see that once I've loaded my workspace view, I get some information under my attributes, and you can also see I now have a 3D ribbon which I didn't have before, which gives all these tools and functions that we can use. So those are the most common things people do with their mesh. Instead of having this mannequin in our display set, we can change it to a skeleton. Of the bones is the one that we use. So we have a picture of our skeleton walking through our 3D workspace. And if you wanted to, you can see in the attributes bar that you can adjust things like the colour, so you can make them a yellow skeleton or a completely white skeleton. And then you can change things like how bright they are, etc. Play through the trial, this is essentially what we captured in Nexus from the subject walking blocks. Okay, so you remember in Nexus that we had the force plate in our 3D workspace. So we can also add this into our polygon report. So under our trial, we all have our force plates. And when you select the header in your data bar, any of its properties or options appear at the bottom left here. So we've got our first force plate. And what I can do is I can right click and choose to show you the object. Okay, so then this adds our force plate into the 3D workspace. And this purple thing that you can see here is what we call the force plate butterfly. Which is essentially the trace of the force vector. And as you can see, it has the typical ground reaction force curve. Okay, but if you look at the top view, okay, we can also see that it will show the typical kind of center of pressure movement across the plate. I scrub back through the trial where the subject who has the foot on the plate, you can see there is a yellow vector which represents their force vector. Okay, so that is red in Nexus, the polygon looks like yellow. If you think that this is too cluttered and it doesn't show, if you want to highlight the force vector and you think that say the butterfly is crowd the image, you can select it, and then you see when I select it, the option to remove it becomes active. Okay, so when you've got nothing selected, and if you select an object, there's the option to remove it. So you might end up with a view like this where you can watch your subject. The other thing that we have in the time bar is this scroller here, so it can control the speed of the playback. Okay, so if you think that the normal speed is too fast, then you can slow it down in your particular report. Other options that we can do with our workspace view is, for example, you might want to show where the markers were placed on the subject. So we can do this by selecting the trajectories, and you'll see we then get a list of populated trajectories. And I can go down and like double clicking on the markers that you place on the subject, you'll see that they are slowly getting added into our workspace. Now, if you wanted to, like you did with the skeleton, you could select the markers in the workspace, and you could also change the color of them so that they highlight the highlights better. So once you've made an edit, we can create hyperlinks. And what the hyperlink allows to do is basically think of it as like a web page where we have a bunch of text. And if we want to bring up this particular view, we can create a link so that when a person clicks on it, this view of your subject performing a movement shows up. So before I create the hyperlink, I want to position the workspace view both where I want it in the report and also perhaps the angle that I want the view to open in. So if I want my 3D workspace to be in a different location, I can grab the workspace view tab or title bar, and you see once I start dragging it, little arrow sections appear as to where I can potentially drop this window. So I might choose that I want this view, and I might want it slightly larger as my view to a hyperlink. So this is the kind of view and angle that I want. Next thing is, within my report, is to create a hyperlink. Now you can just create a link itself, or you can write some text, prompting someone to click on a location to view this. Okay. So for example, I might type something like, so I'm going to make a little kind of introduction, and then I'm going to create a global link by coming up to my report button, pressing the global link, and typing in here so that this creates a link. Okay, so what this allows us to do is when someone opens a report and they see this, they can start reading it and they can say, okay, I want to do the walking, and they click on that link. case that working in a, what you do in a 3D workspace, we should do the same thing with graphs. So for example, with my kinematic data, if I wanted to have a look at, say, the knee angle, I can come over here into my, under my angles header, double click knee angles, and it will give me the three knee rotations. Okay, and then I can scale the graph by using my mouse buttons to zoom in and out or sideways. Okay, so the three types of as you can see here, we've got flex extension, you add adduction, and then the rotation of your what you can do is you can graph multiple angles, like similar to what we showed you in yesterday with the grip balls. So let's stick on the kinematics. And we might want to create some graphs where we have the hip, the knee, and the ankle angle. Okay, so I've loaded in hip, knee, and ankle angles. Alright, but you might think it's kind of hard to and tedious to kind of flick through and look at all the angles at the same time. You know, maybe I just want a quick snapshot to have a look at what the angles are. So to do this, in my graph option, there is a feature to thumbnail to view. So that I can put these into thumbnails, and you can see here that we have going along the rows, we have the joint, so the hip, the knee, and the ankle. And then down the columns, we have the three rotations, so flexion extension, adduction, and rotation. So you can have a quick look at how the, you know, each joint is contributing in the gait cycle. And you'll see that the curves, they've been normalized. So because we put the gait cycle events in the time bar in X's, that polygon that automatically takes those and shows the normalized curve. You see down at the bottom, we've got, it might not be too clear in the on the projector, but there's this kind of green shaded area, okay, and it says stands there. And then over this blue section it says swing, so it represents the two phases. If you don't want to see the normalized curve, then you can untoggle the normalized button and it will give you the knee angle for the complete trial. So what's the benefit of normalizing the data? So besides always having a constant time frame for the given angle, so you know where exactly the start and the finish is, in Polygon we can work with multiple trials. Okay, so I'm going to go back to my data manager and I'm going to load in the second trial. step. And I'm just going to close this graph, go back to my first one, and show the knee-angles again. Okay, so I can import knee-angles from the first trial. I can import angles from my second trial. So I'll do the knee-angles as well. And then from here, so you have six tabs, three from the first trial, three from the second. And what I can do is I can grab the flexion extension tab of the second trial and drop it onto my first. And repeat that for the other rotations. And because I put in the gate cycle events, this is a direct comparison now from foot strike to foot off between the two trials. Okay. And why is there such a difference? Well, this first trial here was of our subject walking, whereas the second trial they were doing a little bit of a jog. Okay. So if you wanted to, for example, have this as a comparison, then we could also create a hyperlink